Howdy, man. Welcome to day 258, Make It Songbringer. Today I'm working on some more data-driven stuff. Slowly but surely, making the engine easier to use so I can do things faster, create art faster, and get in the game faster. What's up, Pedro? What's up? How you doing, man? How did everything turn out? With your legs? That operation. So, what I've done is I've created this function called create entity. This is now a really basic function that takes everything from a profile, so the data for whatever is like a blob. And each one of the components has a different valtry, you know, a section of data, so that an entity can be created completely from data now. Nice. Oh, that's right. Your tailbone. You got their stitches removed? Nice. Cool, man. Right on. So there's one issue, and that's where it creates a being, or you walk off the screen, you come back, and the entity all of a sudden, oh, here it is. Yes, you can sit now. That's awesome. What's up, Dodge Whale? Yeah, I'm posting in the creative section. Is that, should I not be doing that? I've gotten this question a couple times. People say creative section. Yeah, you can post in the creative section for game development, but you can put on like tags like game dev and programming, and that's kind of cool. I thought the tags were kind of a neat thing. So, but yeah, is there something wrong with that? What's up, PETA? Welcome to the stream, man. Belzeo. Actually, I don't think this is necessary anymore. What's up, KX? Oh, just curious. Okay, all right. We'll see if that fixed it. Oh, the problem was that an enemy would die, and then you'd walk off screen, come back on screen, and the skin they had was no longer being applied. So, like, I kill one of these. He's blue colored. Walk off screen, walk back on. All right, he's still blue colored. Yay. All right, another bug fixed. One bites the dust. All right, and this last bit, there's some enemies have a flag called no remove. Which makes it so when the entity dies, they still have their collision component. And it looks like the one enemy that does that is the sack, the spider sack. So let's make sure that this new remove. Yo, what's up, Bit of Barney? Welcome to the stream, man. All right, so we'll go somewhere that has one of these sacks. Like 1, 2, 2. And what should happen is once I kill this spider sack thing, it should still have its collision component. And I should be able to walk off the screen and walk back on, and it should still have its collision component. Whoa. Whoa. It's a really dark area. Okay, I'm just gonna cheat. Yeah, good. Okay, so I can't walk around here. That's great. Hopefully that's the key we need. Oh, what happened there too? Alright, so that didn't show the item there. We got the biodetector. I was hoping for the yellow key. Let's give the player all the keys for this area. Nice, right on, yay, cool. That's totally what I would have recommended. Is that Vlambeer article, right on. Yeah, this is spooky and crazy enemies too. So to be able to walk off the screen and check this, I gotta give the player the keys for this area. Thanks, Win It All. I'm glad you said that. Although this dungeon is totally unfinished, so the artwork you're looking at is not that good compared to what it will be. So thank you, and it will look even better, I promise. Maybe not on today's stream, but eventually, all these dungeons are gonna look cool. All right, so we need the keys for area 2. No, no, that would be 2, 1. Two, 2, 2, 3. Probably just 2, 2 will cover it. So what I'm looking for is this door should be open now. All right, great, the door is open. And looks like we got a little crash here. Spider direction. So I've got this one bit of code now for all entities, all behaviors. It's a little bit more strict on how it runs its behavior trees. If there's a certain node of the behavior tree that doesn't compute, it now lets me know with an assertion failure. This would never crash in a release mode build, but for debug mode builds, this will always crash. So invalid behavior, spider direction. So dir target requires a target. So probably what's going on is that this spider doesn't have a target and it's trying to set a direction towards the target. And it's like, dude, I can't do that. So there's something in here for dir target. There's a couple of those right there. We need if target any. There we go. Okay, so that should fix that. Basically just checks if it has a target before it sets the direction towards the target. This guy still has an animation he's running. I need to fix that. And also this no remove. Wait, what was it that I was doing with all this again? Oh yeah, setting the collision category to be static. Right, there's a smarter place I could do that. Right when it creates the entity Like right here. Right. Okay, no problem. Collision flags. So we'll just manually apply this collision flag or a static this category based on the fact that we've created it with the no remove right here. So we'll get the collision component and add the flag or I mean the category. All right, we don't even really need this. Category static, great. And now this doesn't need to do that anymore. Okay, let's make sure that worked. So instead of setting that flag, that simple thing that I mean the category to be static in create being, I'm doing it in create entity at a more basic level. So basically all entities will have this smartness built into them when they can be created from data. Oh, we got another one of these invalid behaviors. Droid bat, dir target probably. Dir target, yep. Man, this is kind of an annoying thing actually, all having all these bugs, but I guess it makes sense. You know what? Hell, I should fix this all at once right now. Target any. Dir target. Let's check all these. That one's good because it sets the target. That one's good. That one's good. This one's bad. Here's one other one that needs it. Drop boss, target none, cool. Target any, great. Here's another one. Got that there. Got it. Got it. Hey, Belzeo. What's up, Marza? Target any here. What's up, Azarus? You have a headache? Damn, man. A bad one. Did you try drinking water? Did you try standing on your head? I know it's kind of a weird thing, but standing on my head always helps me. But I guess it would, you know. Standing on my head, and there's lotus pose too. I guess, you know, if you know any yoga, lotus pose can really, really clear a headache away. SQL all day, huh? Ah, how's it going? I'm just filling in all these. I'm making sure these dirt targets are not ever gonna crash again. All these require if target any to accurately target something or set a direction towards a target, I mean. Target. You won? All right. Oh, okay, if it's not that bad, I hear you. Yeah, I get those a lot too. I'll have like slight headaches. Oh, damn. Really? Just now? That sucks. Oh. Yeah. Great suggestions here. Cool. Okay, now that those are fixed. Turn off and on the house. Dude, pretty soon we are actually gonna be able to do that. Yeah, Pedro, what kind of game controller do you have? And how do you like it? Oh, it's a PS2, huh? Oh, wow, cool. I love those. Okay, so I'm still wondering. I think it's still gonna do this bug with the after I. Let's kill all these guys. Like all these guys, they're supposed to be dead. They are actually dead. All their entities are completely, you know, inactive. But the problem is that they are still running their idle animations, so that's. Yeah, I added a new command to do that. It's really handy. There's a command to kill the player, and there's a command to kill all the entities on the screen. So if I press 2, it kills everybody. All the enemies. If I press 1, it kills the player. So I can test that. That's pretty handy. Yeah, God mode. I haven't added a shortcut key for that. I probably should. But anyways, I do want to fix this bug. What's causing? Okay, one thing I want to check. Let's go back to the overworld. And there's The blobs, for example. If I kill a blob, walk off the screen. Yeah, look at that. So the blob. Oh no, wait, wait. This guy still has his. He's running his idle animation. He's like, yeah, I'm alive. Oh, you know what? It probably just needs this. If we've got a frame to run when we. Oh. This is totally wrong. This needs to run if the player has a skin or not. Oh, that's what it is. Okay. Here, I figured out the bug. Yay! So when it creates a skin for an entity, it needs to do it here. And then, or it needs to do the idle. And then this bit down here should be in if dead. Oh no. Yeah, sorry guys, if it's going crazy, I don't know what's up, but Twitch has been crazy lately. But also, I will admit that some of it seemed like it was on my end yesterday. My internet was really, really crazy yesterday till the evening. So my apologies if the stream is crazy today or if it buffers a lot or whatever. It could be our internet here in this area right now. Or it could be Twitch. Who knows? Right, so idle, this would be frame 0. And then. So if not alive, we just set no animation and we want to do the last frame of the release animation there. Oh man, this is really great to be able to create an entity without having to write a single line of code. That's what this is all about. Pretty cool. So this guy right here, he doesn't have any skins. So that's why it's good to test both those kinds of enemies right there. Walk off the screen, walk back on. Yeah! Fixed it! All right, let's go back to, what was that area? I think it was 1, 2, 2. Is that right? Just a guess. Bueller. Oh, yeah, good guess. Alright, it worked. Yes, beautiful. Okay. Yeah, check in time. Alright, let's check that bit in. That's really good. Added these if target anys to all the profiles that needed it. I fixed the dead animation. Guess you could just the dead frame, sprite frame. Cool. All right, so right. Yeah. So what's great about that is now I can take something like, you know, right now it's working really well to create foes, enemies, neutrals, NPCs, anything that's alive, a living entity, it can be really easily created. But now that I've got this new method to create an entity in general, not just a living entity, I could use this to create something like a plant or a rock or something like that. Instead of having to write all this code in this area creation method, there's like a separate function for every one of these kinds of tiles, like a pillar, some stairs, a light sconce, a bush, a plant, you know, the rock face or whatever. All of these are not all going to be able to be pure data. Some of them are going to require code. There's some actually complex stuff going on, especially for like mountain tiles, because it piles them all up together and stuff. But there will be some of these entities in here which can easily be created with just pure data, so I will be able to get rid of some of these methods. So now it's time to choose what to do next. I've got this create entity method. I guess it would be nice to try it out with some kind of easy tile. Like a bomb. Not really. This thing's got a moods. Moods are like this old school way of doing AI. I have two systems for doing AI, because I haven't converted all my other stuff over to behavior trees yet. There's a couple things in the game that still run with behavior trees. A rock tile, you would think that's an easy thing to create, but that's also piles up a lot of other, it's based on other entities around it. Oh, here's one. I can do the grow back tiles. What's up, Platform Labs? Things have been great, dude. How about yourself? How are you? Okay, here's a simple test of this method. BC Warrior. So what I did is I just switched the grow back tiles to use the new create entity method, and they do appear fine. Awesome. Love it. Yeah. Bafu. Yeah, same there. Nice. Okay, good. That worked. Is there anything else I can do that's a very easy thing? Bush tile, no. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe this isn't as easy as I thought, but in the future going forward, I can create new entities using this method. Pillar tile? That one's pretty small. Yeah, oh well. Wow, only 10 seconds? It's pretty good. Yo, thanks for following. Okay, yeah, let's move on to the next thing. Too much code. I wish all this code could just pew, instantly be data, but it's not that easy right now. But what is good is that it's prepared. The system is prepared and is working now on that kind of level where it can work easily in the future and just be pure data. All right, so I've been wanting to do this thing for the data-driven systems to get the the world thing. So let's go to the world data. This is going to be game world.txt. This is where I was last week. I was working on this whole data-driven world thing. I'm going to get back into this and create entities from this. Yeah. I know, that's what I'm saying. 10 seconds doesn't seem that bad. Okay, so what the areas need, all the areas of the world need a string value that specifies what data to use inside the world. So for example, the overworld tree will have all the data about the overworld. The stone tree will have everything about this stone looking dungeons. The psychedelic dungeons will be under this tree. So basically every area needs a pointer or like a string value that points to these values. So then I can read these on the fly. I know, it would be great, right? How do you do that? Is that possible? Can you add your own syntax highlighting to Xcode? It'd be silly if you couldn't. Okay, so each area. Or maybe a val tree, actually. Yeah, I bet there's a way, huh? Nice. Right on, man. Yeah, we can. So it would be in like a function like area creation where it creates the entrance tile. This has a lot of different things it loads, which is everything in red here, all of these strings, every one of these strings could be pure data. Now, this is a really easy opportunity to load stuff from this world data. All right, but the one thing about this entrance tile is there's two types of entrance tiles. All right, so probably this probably is a good place to start then. So for example, how would I do this for stone? I guess stone entities entrance. See, the problem is, okay, there's two types of entrances. Yay! Yeah! For example, the stone entrance path would look like that. Entrance. This needs a good key. Entrance path, I guess, would be. Oh, entrance images. Entrance images path. Yeah. So then I could lay out the other ones. So the problem, oh man, this is such a tricky thing because I would want to do the same a similar thing for the overworld. Only the problem is that the overworld has a different entrance for a different flag number. I think I know what to do. If I could do it this way, like entrance here, and then entrance on the overworld would be something else. So then the entrance tile would just need to know the difference. Okay, that could work. Is marketing working? Hell yeah. Totally is. I'm constantly getting emails from people saying, "Hey, I'd love to review your game." There's constantly more followers on every one of the social networks, you know, Twitter, Facebook, Twitch. Yeah, so there's tons of interest, there's tons of growth still. The problem is right now the game is not anywhere near complete. So most people are not like hardcore fans. Most people are gonna see this game if it's in their genre and they would like playing this kind of game, like retro Zelda-y type game. They're gonna look at it, most people, and go, "Cool, I love the look of this game. I'm gonna keep my eye out for that game when it comes out." You know what I mean? They're not gonna want to play it right now. They're not gonna want to pre-order it and stuff. But if it was out, they would play it in a heartbeat. So that's the challenge right now. There's lots of interest and stuff like that. But because the game is being released sometime in the future, it's not It's not immediate. People can't take immediate action on that and actually play the game right now unless they, you know, pre-order and stuff like that. So I expect, I know that's a dangerous thing to say, but I expect when the game gets to being closer to launch, there'll be a lot more pre-orders. I'm hoping there'll be more pre-orders. And also, when the game is actually, okay, sorry, man. All right, so images, path, yeah, this will work. Yeah, entrance overworld. Let's do it for a really simple tile, though, like the light pillar is a great example of. Maybe that's not the best one. Right? Exactly. Get pillar frame. This is a good example of a function that we don't need once we have this data set right. I'm gonna take away this print. I never use the print command. Who uses the print command? Was X, oh crap, I just killed Xcode. Whoops. What's up, Solar Flare? Man, it's going really good, dude. There's a new trailer that just came out, and all that's in preparation for Indie Cup. I'm not sure if you saw that or whatever, but yeah, the game's gonna be coming to Indie Cup. So I'm really, really hyped for that. And everything I'm doing right now is kind of leading up to having an Indie Cup, because if I could win this $10,000 prize, that would be so awesome. I'd have the funds I need to finish this game and finish it well. Yeah, so yeah, that trailer is basically intended for Indie Cup to get the game, you know, the judges for Indie Cup are picking like eight finalists or whatever, and they're picking them before they ever play them. So it's all based on the trailer. So I had to have a better trailer. I'm like, dude, I gotta upgrade my trailer because there's 30 games going to Indie Cup, and they're all, or not all of them, but you know, a good like 10 of the games are good enough for sure to be finalists. So I wanted to up my game on that. But as far as the actual game goes, I'm working a lot on making the game more data driven. So it's gonna make it way quicker to create new assets once I have this system working with data. I can easily swap in more art and stuff. Basically, it'll make me be able to create new dungeons, new items, new enemies, everything faster. What? Why is that? Nice bit of Barney. Thanks, man. Yeah, I'm a musician, so I had to do that. It really bugs me when I see trailers and they're not on the beat and they're not like synced up with the song. Oh, let me get you the link then. Yes, Solar Flare. It will have modding support. That's another reason why I'm kind of doing this whole foundational work right now of getting the game so it can easily do new, totally new graphics. So that yeah, it's easy for me to create new stuff, but also it's easy to create mods. Here's that trailer. Okay, so once again, in area.h, we're gonna have each one of the areas is gonna have a string for this. Oh, actually, no, we don't need to have every area have a separate instance to whatever Z style it's using. Yeah, we don't need it there. But in world, it'd be a good thing for the world to have a list of strings. So int to string. What's this gonna be called? This is like the world key or the key for each Z level. This is kind of like a style key. That's a good enough name, style keys. Right, Marza. Good night, man. Yeah, style key. And then each area. Wait. Well, there's already a get world data function. Yeah. But now there should be a get world data for a Z level in Z. And in area.h, up there should be a private method. Just called get world data. How do I like Axiom Verge? Definitely one of my favorite games I've played since I was a kid. Yeah. I spent 20 hours completing it the first time around, and I'm already on my second time playing it. I freaking love it. It's so inspiring. And it's like right up my alley. I love playing Metroid, Super Metroid, and all those kind of games. It's like some of my favorites. That and Zelda, I could play those games forever. So Axiom Verge is in ways it's almost better than Super Metroid and all the other Metroids I've ever played, really. It's so good. And in some ways, I do appreciate the older style in Super Metroid. But What was I going to say? The only thing I wish Axiom Verge had, I just wish it was procedurally generated. Because it's so could be. Yeah, for real, man. Definitely well worth the $20 to buy that game. But yeah, if it had procedural, even if it just had procedural music, it would really help. Ori and the Blind Forest. No, I haven't. How's that? What game is that? I'm definitely on the lookout for games that it can inspire me, you know? Oh, sorry, my audio is probably crazy today. Yeah, I haven't played this one. Whoa, this looks pretty good, huh? Wow. Yeah. This looks amazing as far as its visuals go. I wonder about its gameplay. But yeah. You played it? Right on. This definitely looks worth putting on my wish list for sure. So what'd they do? They have downloadable content. How well did it do? Its gameplay is tight, right on. That's awesome. Yeah. Definitely badass. Reminds me of kind of reminds me of Rain World, with it, that awesome water physics, but the art is even better than Rain World. Ori, what's up? Why isn't Ori showing up here? Let's just do Ori. What happened? Did I break it? I think I broke Steam Spy. Come on, find it. Oh, here we go. I'm getting a lot more this time. Must have been in some area. Here we go. So, wow, holy crap, 300,000 people own that game. That's awesome. And look at this, look at the scores this game has gotten. Almost a Metascore of 90. That's rad. That's incredible. So, that company, I'm not exactly sure what they're, what kind of rate they're getting or whatever, but if they just made 70%, and let's aim on the safe side and say that the game only has 300,000 owners on Steam. 300,000 owners times $20 per times 70%. That's still $4 million. It's pretty awesome. Looks like this game totally deserves it. Good for them. 300,000 owners, and it's been out since March. That's great. Yeah, what's that? Why are you surprised? All right, I'm thinking this get world data function could be, yeah, let's just call that get data. This is world anyway, so we'll call that just get data. In world.cpp. We'll do style keys. Man, I wish there was an easier way to link straight to val tree keys. I guess each one of these, I guess it could, yeah, it could just have separate val trees. But anyways, that's an optimization. I probably shouldn't be optimizing this right now. Style keys. Oh, this is static world style keys. Doesn't it like that? What's up, Beetle J? Welcome to the stream, man. Oh. Of course, it's part of world. Oh, I just said, what's up, man? Hello. All right, so here's where we'll set some default styles. Now this is going to be procedurally chosen at random. It'll choose which levels have which styles or whatever. But for now, I'm just going to manually set them all. So style keys. Actually, we should probably do that for every Z level. So like stocky 0 would be overworld. Stocky's 1 would be stone. Stocky's 3 is psychedelic. Yeah, there's teleport cubes. So you'll be able to have two. This is an interesting thing to talk about. I'm thinking maybe you'll have these teleport cubes where you have two of them. And you can place one teleport cube somewhere in the world and then warp back to it. I see the problems with that, though. That's, you know, you can only warp to one place that way. And You can only warp to the place you've already been to. You can only warp back to that one place where your other teleport cube was. So, I don't know, maybe there's a better way to do that. Maybe you can have like little teleportation stations or something like that. I'm not sure. So there we got some default styles set up. Now back to that get data. Yeah, not optimized, but better to do things just the way that's simple at first and then optimize later, I think. We should be able to compile now. And then an area. Can create the getData function. There. Yeah. Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah. And then you that's a great idea because then you could the ship could know what areas it can only warp you maybe to the areas you've been to. I guess it could do it either way. Like it could warp you anywhere or it could warp you to places you've been to, but preferably places you've already been to. Yeah, it's really not that huge. Oh, get world data. Oh, did I forget to make this const? Oh yeah, this should be const. Wow. Holy crap. Let's do the math on that one, huh? 2 million users. Yeah, that's the crazy part. In only 10 days. That's some major hype they got for that game. 2 million users. Times $60. Times maybe they're getting, 50% of that. I guess more, right? They're a Steam company. Yeah, they're probably making at least 70%. So yeah, that's at least $84 million they've already made. Yeah, that's just Steam, right. Yeah, so at least $84 million that game's already grossed. That's awesome. Good for them. Ah, yeah, that's right. What's up, T? Yeah, they're definitely making more. Consoles are pretty huge. They're a pretty huge market. Rocket Bunny, what's up, man? How you doing, dude? Sorry, I missed your tweets. I was taking days off, and when I take days off, sometimes I don't check my tweets or anything. Bapu. Yeah. This is a great example of using this method the right way. So the data would just be this get data. Oh yeah, you know what? Let's make this method easier to use. Instead of get world data, which is long and I'm always going to resent that. So I'm just going to call that data. So this is going to grab the data for this entity. It's just going to be called data. World get data area pause.z. So I can use this with shorthand. Oh, crazy. Oh, did you get it back? Right? What's up, my name? Cheeses? Yeah, you got it back? Cool. Oh, damn. There. We don't need that janky method anymore. So this should create the ground for the overworld now, fine. Once again, here we go. This is a great one also to test. So this would be this get data. Or this data. That gets y'all ground. Yes, yes, yes. Very good. Air brawl? Oh wow, really? Wow, 12K sales in 2 weeks? No worries, man. Might be my fault. Stream's going crazy these days. So this was released in June. Nice. I can see why this would be fun. Whoa. Did he make the music too? Good job. He priced it right. Looks like he made a great game. $12,000 sales in 2 weeks. Was that it when it launched, or was that just like recently? Oh, that's supposed to be, okay, it must have been on early access already or something like that, because this says it was out in June, which means that it was probably early access, and then this says release date November, which who knows what that means. But yeah, okay, so 12,000 users since June, so probably not Well, okay, it launched 2 weeks ago, really? Well, why does it say June here then? Ah. Virtual pizza, anyone? And this one too. Oh, data is just this data. Right, let's see how that worked out. Game Vivo, what's up, man? Okay, some good ways to check this. Starting out at the very first screen, yeah, zero, we can check the ground. The ground should still look fine how it did before. It should be using the ground texture loaded from data, so it's using this data method now for get child ground. I don't know. I don't know anything about health and physical education careers. How does the to-do list work? It doesn't. There's really no to-do list in Xcode. If you're using Visual Studio, it does actually have a to-do list, but Xcode, it doesn't. So what I do is I just set warnings. I don't like doing it this way, actually, because I hate having a list. But anyways. Gripes aside, if you wanted to do a to-do, you could do to-dos like this. You could go warning to-do, I need to do something here, right? And then when you build, you'll generate a warning. And so you can go look at your warnings and say, oh, look. Where is this? It's still compiling area. What's up? Where is this? There. So there's that to-do. I need to do something right here. So that's one way you could do a to-do list in Xcode. Don't know. All right. Good. Okay, what's the next thing? Wait, let's check that, of course. So the ground should still look right here. Good. Right, still loading the ground data. Okay, cool. Let's see if the ground data is still loading well for like area 3. Right on, T. Well, good night, man. Thanks for joining. Hope you're having a good time. Oh yeah, it's working. Oh, I was working on an animation here in this area. So, but anyways, okay, that's working. Good, good, good. Oh, so what's the next thing to do to get this data hooked up? It would be to use an entity from the datas. No worries, man. Good night, dude. Okay, going back to world. Stone entrance. Let's do that. Let's go to the stone entrance. So we'll go to level one and we'll start working on this. So it uses the entrance artwork from right straight from there. It's like we're missing the path right here. Can you write your game with HTML and C++? Yes and no. Mostly no. Mostly no. When you're writing a game with HTML, you're usually writing with JavaScript. There's one exception. You can use C++ with something like this kind of Chrome plugin thing, or there's also some kind of, there's something which converts your C++ to JavaScript out there. I forget what it's called, but both of those are kind of workaround situations. So in general, no, if you're going to write an HTML5 game, write it in JavaScript. It's just going to be way easier unless you really do want it to run perfectly native on native platforms. But on native platforms, you can still run JavaScript as long as you get as JavaScript, compiler in your game. Like for example, Cocos 3DX has that all built in, so you can write games. There it is, mscript. That's it. Yeah, I forgot what that was called. But yeah, GameView. I hope that answers your question there. All right, so we'll go to create entrance tile. And this is the first thing I'm gonna start converting this method to use data instead of all the this hard-coded stuff. Good for you, man. All right, so the data that this thing's gonna use is gonna be this data, get child. Now if we're at area pause dot z equals zero, this is gonna be entrance overworld. Otherwise it's just entrance, right? This is gonna grab the data for those. And then also we're gonna go one level deeper and go dot images, or I could just go images dot path. Yeah, that's fine. My answer, I just answered your question there about HTML and C++. It's up to you. What do you want? What do you want your game to run on? Do you want your game to run on native platforms or HTML5 or both? Have you picked an engine yet? It's really just, it's up to your engine more than it is the language you're going to use, right? You need to go find a game engine. So if I were you, I would go check out game engines until you find one you like. Start learning it before you learn a language. And also check out this. All right, check out this link here. See, this doesn't matter that much. It doesn't matter how your game having great quality graphics. It has nothing to do with what engine you're using, really. What do I mean, game engine? You should really check out this link, man. Sorry. Yeah, just check out this link. Google this. What's a game engine? Right, so what's next on this? Yeah, actually, the player should be at the overworld at this point. So put the player back there. It's a bug there with the ground path getting covered up by a little bit. But oh well. Okay, so yeah, everything on this screen right here, all these, this little path on the ground, the rocks in the background, even this tiles for these statues and stuff, all this we're gonna start loading from data. Okay, one entrance path, for example. Let's make sure that works. So, entrance path. Instead of loading it that way, we can load it this way. So, path would be data.getChild. Images.path. Oh, dot get string. All right, let's see if that worked. Man, this is so great. Finally making this all data driven. Okay, so it didn't work. Something went wrong with the path there. Start figuring that out. Getting cold in here, man. Close the windows. Okay, so why didn't this work? Let's figure that out. That should be images.path and entrance overworld entrance. Both of those stone. Oh, right. Okay, I already know why that's not working. It's not loading it directly. It needs to actually load. It needs to load some different data. All right, so the data would be like this. If areaPos.z equals 0, then we want to load the entrance tiles for the world that we're loading. So that's going to be world get data for this thing's get flag number off of its flags. Dot get child entrance overworld. Otherwise, it's just this get just this data get child entrance. There. Okay, I'm gonna make sure this works by stepping into that. How do I keep track of all the code and what it does? Yeah, it's just basically in what's a wait board? Yeah, really it is. It's just that. It's all kind of kept track of in short-term memory. So my brain doesn't have the capacity to keep this whole game. This is 40,000 lines of code already in this game. So I don't have the capacity to actually remember that after a month or so. But because Rocket Bunny, because I'm coding every single day with this game, it's all kind of fresh in my head. You know how it all works, how it's all structured and all that. I couldn't forget that, you know. But after a month, I'm going to start forgetting the details. You know, if I stopped coding this game right now and I was never worked on it for a whole month, I would forget a lot. And it would take me a day or two or three or even a week to get used to the game again. So it's that. It's just keeping your mind fresh, you know? Oh, whiteboard. I was like, what's a whiteboard? Like, new stuff? What's a whiteboard? I want one. Sign me up, man. I'm gonna order one on Amazon right now. I need a whiteboard fast. Whiteboards. Game Vivo. Obviously, yes. Of course you can make anything you want. You don't need a degree to make stuff. I don't have a degree. I'm making games. Bill Gates did not have a degree. He formed Microsoft. You can do anything. Anything you want. Good. Okay, so this is Z0, so we're gonna do world, get data, get flag number, flag. So let's see if get flag number turns out right. That should be one. Return value one. Good. Now get data for that Z style keys. Key turns out to be stone. Good. Great. That's working. And then off of that, we're gonna do get child entrance overworld. So good. We got the data, we've got the pointing to, oh no, did not work. Get child entrance overworld. Why didn't that work? That should have worked. All right, let's try it again. Okay, once again, I'm stepping into these methods. I want to step in until we get the data, return the data, this dot get child. So let's step into the get child method. Great. So this stone, right, good. The key we're looking for is entrance overworld. Oh, that's because it's underneath entities, of course. Okay. Duh. So really, this should be query entities dot entrance overworld. As well, this one needs to be query. Okay, once again, stepping in this method. And if I step over this, we should have data. Good, we got the overworld data correct this time. Good, good, good. Okay, that should work now. All right, it worked. Yay. Okay, so let's ensure that that worked, prove that that worked by changing the data. So instead of one entrance path, let's set it to be two entrance path. Yes, yes, Pedro. Good. Yeah, that worked. What's going on? Dude, why did the frame rate drop so hard? That was weird. Game show. Game show's killing it again. It's eating up over 150% of the CPU right now. Crap, dude. This means the stream's probably going to crash soon. Hope not, but it probably will. Because Max. Okay, well, it's not the fact. It doesn't have anything to do with the code I just wrote. That's what I was caring about. So anyways, okay, let's move on to the next bits here, like images path. The next thing would be... Actually, let's just get images straight up from all of these. Images. Ground. So yeah, the ground would be the same kind of thing. So ground. Entrance, one entrance, ground. Born to Snipe. What's Game Show? It's a software that streams. All right, good. The ground's working. Let's verify that that did work by taking off a letter, and then we should have no ground this time. Oh, that didn't work. Damn, why not? Xbox Taco, what's up, man? Good night, Vivo. Yeah, Born to Snipe. I moved away from OBS because my voice was out of sync and the audio was horrible quality because I couldn't get it to record my desktop audio. So you guys always had to listen to my game running through the laptop speakers. Like it was horrible audio quality. So this new thing, Game Show, has way better audio quality and it's always in sync. The problem is it crashes and it does this thing where it gets to be using 150 to 200% of the CPU at all times, which is crazy annoying. So the file it's trying to load is one entrance ground.ping, which does not exist. Oh, just because ground is something else. Of course. Okay. So that's fine. Let's move on to some other stuff like left and right. It'll be more obvious. It's a feature. Right. It's a feature. Is streaming game development useful? Well, there's two ways to answer that. It comes from two. Oh, for feedback. Oh. So yes, as a game developer, streaming can be very useful for feedback. Incredibly useful. You get instant feedback. And normally, the way it's always worked for game developers is you make your game, and then you either have your friends test it, or you hire some people that are going to gameplay test your game, and then you watch them and you get feedback from them. And that's also instant feedback, but that's not something everyone can afford, and not everyone has like a million friends they can go rely on to play their game and stuff like that. So getting this instant feedback is really, really great. It's incredibly helpful. And in fact, if it wasn't for the stream and people here on this stream, the Kickstarter probably wouldn't have succeeded, because I wouldn't have got that great instant feedback from people. People commented on, you know, you should make your rewards better on the Kickstarter. You should make your description better. You should make your video better. Like all these great comments and all that instant feedback. True. Yeah. Friends can be biased, and also friends can be dishonest in ways, because you're, and it's not that they want to be dishonest. It's just that they want, most of your friends are going to be seeking your approval in a way. You know what I mean? That's kind of how friendship works. You're always kind of like not wanting to hurt your friends. So if you come up with, if you have a thought about your friend's game and you think, oh my God, my friend's game sucks, and they're probably not going to share it in that way. But, you know, or maybe they just have a comment like, dude, it would be so great if your keys could do this or whatever, your enemies should do that. Sometimes they're not going to be completely honest about that. Or sometimes you might be biased because you have a friendship with that person. You might be biased and not quite hear them with their giving their honest feedback. And so you might not be taking it the right way. So yeah, it can be really helpful to do live streaming. What's the stage of this game? It's about 50% complete. It's going to be, unless I have to do early access, which I'm hoping I don't. I prefer to launch it as late as possible. Like maybe, you know, sometime next year. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Left, right, back. Thomas, what's up, man? Yeah, so much has changed. How you doing, man? How's everything going? So we'll keep on loading this stuff from data. Man, this is awesome. This is like something I should have done a long time ago. But now that I'm doing it, so glad that it's that way. Yay. Jib love. Jib love. Yeah? All right, cool, man. Good to hear. Yeah, Jib love all around. Jib. Okay, so this screen should still have the pillars and stuff that are around the elevator thing. Good. Still got that. Now let's take away one of them. Like let's misspell right. And now it shouldn't have that right pillar. Excuse me, that right pillar. Good. All right, that worked. And as well, oh yeah, and it also doesn't have the rock bit here. The collision entity is not there either. Yeah, good. Oh, that's awesome. Man, that's so awesome. Yeah. All right, so this is so great, having this data-driven. Starting to be data-driven. Data structuring in C? No, not necessarily. Data structure, what do you mean exactly? What's that? What are you talking about? Oh. Thomas, one thing my stream's been dying every time, or crashing every time I go open up a bunch of YouTube videos. So I'm on like a no YouTubes while I'm streaming diet right now. So what? Tell me about this. Is it cool? I'm definitely gonna check it out later. Oh, data, is this what I would consider data structuring in Xcode? No, not necessarily either. No, this is more of structuring data specifically for a game. It's not necessarily Xcode or the C-based language or anything. Am I answering your question right? Is that, you have something else you're trying to ask there? Kind of, yeah, kind of like queuing up something for later. It's really the goal. Okay, Platformer Labs, the goal here is this: to separate code from data. All right, the goal is that when I want to create a new entity in the game, I don't want to have to write any code. Like, all I want to do is be able to just specify some data and say ba-bam, there's a new entity. I don't have to code anything, and it can really make your game more maintainable. It can make it very quickly and rapid for you to create new stuff. And in general, making things data-driven is just a good thing. It can save you a lot of time as a developer, both in the short term and the long term. Nice, right on. Yeah, I'll check that out. So we're almost done fixing up this method. We got left, right, back. Oh, actually, that's all. Oh, wait, there's one more here. One entrance. Oh, it's just one entrance. That's right. Oh, my God, look at this. That's a bug waiting to happen. I had a percent D and a percent S, but only had one. Oh my God, that's so bad. This one too. Oh, I'm so glad I'm getting rid of this code. So I'm debating on what to call this middle entity. I could call it entrance. That's not really a good name. Main might be a good word for it. Yeah, let's do main. This thing elevates though. So it might be better to call this elevator. Or dais or platform. I guess main would be all right. Okay. All right. Yeah, in general, separating your code and your data is always a good thing. So remember that. Separate your code and your data. So now we don't need any of this stuff here. We might not even need file or prefix. Yeah, good. And let's check one more thing. If we take that away or misspell it, we should no longer have the middle entity. Oh, we'll still have it, but we won't be a render component. Yeah, it's gone. Great. And now we don't need this kind of bad code either. I was checking specifically for if the area pause was Z, it would do the left, right, these things. Now these can be specified in data, so there's no worries. Cool. Oh, that's awesome. Rocket Bunny, dude, I would love to read that. If you want to share that, that'd be sweet. Oh, why the cry face? Do you like 3D or something? Oh, you just don't like writing essays. Oh, yeah, I hear you. All right, there's only one more thing left to do with this method, and that's to go test out the underground version, the when you're inside a level. This should still load from data, but it should load the other tree. So let's get the player down in the bottom. Yeah, it looks like it is working because there should be some art right there and it's not even displaying it. So yeah, me too. Man, that's cool to hear that coming from you. Honestly, you're so young. You're like 12 years old and you love pixelated games too. That's a real verification for me because I knew I loved pixelated games, but I thought it was because I grew up that way. So to hear you say that too means that not everybody is, it's not just nostalgia that makes retro games so appealing today. Yeah, true. You are forced to use imagination. Oh, yeah, what does it say? I think it says Songbringer. It's meant to be like a label, you know, like an old school disc label that says Songbringer. Did the stream just die just now? It's like about to, I swear. This thing is not happy. It's fine? Okay. It's fine for now. All right, I'm gonna set a breakpoint here because this isn't working. It should be. Right, so the data it loaded, oh, it's empty. This data get child entities. Oh. Yeah, entities.entrance.images. Yeah, probably. Good, it's loading this one. This get data, this should return something good. And then get child. Good, yeah, the data is fine. Oh, it's because I'm using get child. Should be query. Man, I really need to make those the same method. Get child and query, they're the exact same thing. Yeah, cool. So we don't want to see these things though, these left, right, and back things. So let's get rid of those for when we're in the actual level. So it'll still have main, it'll still have the path, and it'll still have ground. Ground might not be necessary, I don't know. Bucky Paper's gonna save the world, that's right. We need to coat all of our underground underwater internet cables with Bucky Paper right now. So let's try taking away this ground. I'm not sure if that's necessary. I'm not even sure what that is, one entrance ground. Oh, that was the background. Of course that is necessary. Okay. That's good. That's necessary. That might not be necessary. I could take her out that path at this point. But we'll keep it. We'll keep it. That's good enough. All right. That's it for today's stream. I'm just going to check in some code now. And yeah, that's it for today. I'll be back tomorrow doing my wizardy stuff, working on this game more and more. Hopefully, by tomorrow. Well, I'm not sure what I'll be doing tomorrow. I'll either be working on Jib and making him way cooler and playable. Or I'll be working on the psychedelic dungeons. No! But yeah, it's been a good time. Yeah, I had a good time with you guys. Yeah, get some sleep for sure. See you guys. Have a good night. Enjoy yourselves.